Information, please. Presented each week at this time by Canada Dry, famous the world over for its fine beverages. Wake up, America. Time to stump the experts. Would you like to turn the tables and make the authorities answer your questions? Information, please, gives you the chance to do the questioning by putting the experts on the spot. Here's how. Now listen carefully because we will not repeat this announcement again during this broadcast. You send us questions on any subjects with the correct answers. You may submit from 1 to 3 original questions per letter. If your question is used, you receive $5 and $10 additional if it stumps the board. So you may win $15 in all. Don't get upset if our editorial staff changes or edits your question slightly. All questions become the property of Information, Please. Letters with questions are to be addressed to Canada Dry, 1 Pershing Square, New York City. Now here's our master of ceremonies, Mr. Clifton Fadiman, literary critic of the New Yorker magazine. Mr. Fadiman.
Thank you, Mr. Krause. Ladies and gentlemen, Information, Please, as many of you know, is an unrehearsed, spontaneous, catch-as-catch-can program. We found we have more fun that way. Our board of experts this evening consists of 3 veterans and 1 newcomer. The newcomer, ladies first, is that famous and beloved novelist known to millions of Americans, Mrs. Kathleen Norris. Oscar Levant, pianist and composer, will exhibit his knowledge of the 7 arts this evening. The genial columnist to the New York Post, Franklin P. Adams, will demonstrate his learning. And whatever these 3 don't know, we expect will be answered by the practically infallible specialist in general knowledge, the redoubtable John Kieran. Now, if any of you experts know the answer, you raise your right hand. Then, when or if the answer given is incorrect, Canada Dry rings up $10 on the cash register. And those $10 go out to the lucky questioner. All ready, Mrs. Norris and gentlemen? Let's go. The first question comes from Newark, New Jersey, from Mr. Arthur Young. Mr. Young wants you to give 4 common expressions that seem to involve a great feat of strength. For example, to catch a train. Do you get me? Mrs. Norris gets me. I hope you gentlemen do too. Very well, let's have 4 more. Mrs. Norris.
To raise the roof.
To raise the roof is a very good one. Yes, that's 1. Mr. Adams.
To take a bath.
Oh,
to take a bath. Well, now, for some of us, that may involve a great feat of willpower, but not necessarily a great feat of strength, I shouldn't say.
Well, to take a trolley.
To take a trolley is all right, yes. It's a little bit like catching a train, you'll admit, Mr. Adams, won't you? Mr. Levant.
To throw the bull.
To throw the bull is a very good one, yes. That's 2. Mrs. Norris.
To upset the whole house.
Well, to upset the whole house. That's very good. Very good figurative expression. Mr. Kieran.
To upset the apple cart.
To upset the apple cart.
Oh, copycat.
Might not involve a great feat of strength, I think. An apple cart could be upset.
It's easy for you?
No, I'm no specialist in upsetting apple carts, but it could be done. Mr. Levant.
To fan the breeze.
To fan the breeze.
That's pretty subtle.
It's tough. Yeah, it's pretty subtle. Well, I'll accept that. I can think of a few more. To swing an election might be another. Mr. Adams, do you have one?
To hit the hay.
To hit the hay.
That wouldn't take strength.
Not a feat of strength.
That's weakness.
How about kicking the gong?
Pardon?
Kicking the gong around.
Kicking the gong around, yeah. Possibly.
Kicking
purging
the bucket.
A party.
Kicking the bucket.
To move mountains.
Yes, move mountains. Those are all expressions involving a seeming great feat of strength. Very good. The next question from Miss Anna Hogan of San Francisco. This involves a knowledge both of Shakespeare and of modern slang. I'm sure all of you possess that double knowledge. I'm going to ask you to translate the following 5 quotations from Shakespeare into modern American slang. For example, there is, I think, a quotation from Shakespeare goes something like this, "For I am slow of study." Something like that. Would that be right, Mr. Kieran?
Yes.
And the slang expression paralleling it might be, "Boy, am I dumb." I'll have to say that because none of my experts could possibly say that with any truth. Now we have 5 quotations from Shakespeare. You have to translate 4 out of 5 of them into slang. 1, stand not upon the order of your going, but go at once. Mrs. Norris.
Scram.
Very good, Mrs. Norris. Mrs. Norris, do you use that type of language in your books?
No, and I consider this sacrilege, Mr. Spencer.
Yes, it's I'm surprised you even knew the word, Mrs. Norris. 2, this was the noblest Roman of them all. Mr. Adams?
Some boy.
Some boy would be dandy, yes. Very good. Friends, Romans, countrymen, lend me your ears. Mr. Adams?
Get a load of this.
Get a load of this.
Four, is she not passing fair, Mr. Levant?
She's a swell dish.
Yes, that would be a good one. Ain't she a honey? Ain't she a cutie?
A cup of tea.
Cup of tea, yes. Your
My
cup of tea. Right?
Not yours.
Now we have 4 out of 5, but let's get the 5th anyway for good measure. He was a man of an unbounded stomach.
He could eat like a pig.
Yes, that wouldn't be exactly modern slang, I shouldn't think. Perhaps we can do a little better than that. Mr. Kieran, got any bright ideas? He was a man of an unbounded stomach.
He could pack it away.
Yes, I think the phrase means literally,
How he looked.
Yes, oh boy, what a bay window. Yes. Something like that, I think, yes. The next question from Mr. James Saunders of Detroit, Michigan. Now, this is a musical question. I'm going to ask you to identify the newsreel from the following musical scores which figure prominently in the opening part of the newsreel, and the pianist is going to play them. There are 5 altogether, the themes from well-known newsreels, and you'll have to identify the newsreel. Number 1. Anybody want to have that done again? Perhaps you missed
I don't think it would help me.
No, it wouldn't help you, Mr. Levant. Mr. Levant, do you miss the trumpets and the brasses and all that sort of thing?
I didn't want to have it done at all.
Don't like it at all, Mr. Well, it's too late. We have to have it. Annie, do you want to make a guess at that? That's what you're going to do for the rest of this question anyway. I can see that. You may as well start guessing now and get some practice.
Give me the first initial.
Do you want to have that again? No, I can't give you any initials.
I don't know it that
way. All right, don't know. That's one wrong. All right, number 2.
What is it?
I'll tell you later on. Mr. Levant?
20th Century Fox.
That's right.
There's a drum roll logo. Yum-bum. Yum-bum.
Yeah, I'm sorry yum-bum. We can't give that to you, but that is correct. All right, number 3. Mr. Levant?
Paramount.
That's right. Well, you do know this.
Well, I like the ending better.
You want to go through it yourself?
That's all.
That's very nice. Yes, thanks very much. Number 4. Mr. Levant again.
MGM without the lion.
MGM without the lion. Very good.
Very good.
Mr. Levant, you do go to the movies, don't you?
They come to me, too.
We're lucky to have you here tonight. Number 5. Throw up your hands, Mr. Adams.
Sounds like the song of the flame.
Don't take that. I don't think that's a newsreel. This is the only one of the 5, by the way, that I knew, Mr. Levant. Does that make you feel bad? No, of course not.
I better you say it, and I'll tell you if it's right.
No, I won't even whisper it. How about guessing it? Mr. Kieran, he guesses.
One guess is as bad as another. I'll say Pathé.
No, sorry.
March of Time
is the answer.
I could tell by your lips.
Yes, you could tell by listening to me. Well, we just missed out on that by 1, and $10 is going to go to Mr. Saunders of Detroit, Michigan.
What was number 1 on
that? Tough question. The first one was Pathé News.
I thought they had a rooster like we had.
I know, but I can't put that on the piano.
Well, that's where we got our rooster.
Now, Mr. Kieran, our rooster is patented. The next question from Mrs. Lloyd Motz of New York City. I'm going to ask you to name 5 book titles, each of which contains the name of some denomination of money. Oh, cents, dollars, francs, guilders, anything of that sort. It doesn't have to be American. For example, The Moon and Sixpence would be 1. Of course, all of you 4 were thinking of that. Mr. Adams.
Hard cash.
No, it has to be a specific denomination. Oh. I'm sorry.
Does it have to be money or just a figure?
No, it has to be a figure of money. Mrs. Norris.
A flat iron for a farthing.
I don't know the name. I don't know the book. I'm sure that's right. Who wrote it?
Juliana Ewing.
Very good.
An English child story.
Ah, you know too much for it, Mrs. Norris. I'm sure that's right. Mr. Adams.
The 3 black pennies.
3 black pennies by whom?
Joseph Hergesheimer.
Very good, Mr. Adams. Thank you. That's 2.
20,000 leagues under sea is no good.
A league is not. No, a league. No. Even a C is not really a denomination. Now, we have 2 so far. It doesn't have to be American money, you understand. But it may not be Confederate money. Mr. Adams.
The million-pound banknote.
Yeah. Who wrote it?
Mark Twain.
The million-pound banknote sounds familiar to me. I'm going to accept that. That's 3. Mr. Kieran.
The 12-pound look by Chesterton.
Not by Chesterton.
Oh, Barry.
Pardon me. But you got the title right. The 12-pound look.
I played
it. Famous play by Barry. I think Ethel Barrymore used to play in it. I'm not sure.
The one
that's 4. Did you have 1, Mr. Levant?
I had 12 pound look.
All right, you keep that. For interest, Mrs. Norris.
Brewster's Millions wouldn't go, would it?
No, I'm sorry. It has to be a specific denomination.
Has to be specified.
That's an awfully generous title, but I don't think I can accept it.
Get rich quick, Wallingford has no money in it.
No, and I won't take any of the Buck Rogers' books either.
Wasn't there a book called Dollar Diplomacy?
Dollar Diplomacy, Dollar that's Diplomacy. Right. By Nearing and Freeman. That's five. Very good. Thank you very much indeed. I can think of a few others.
Nonsense novels.
I beg your pardon? Nonsense novels?
Oh, come on.
Yes. I'm glad we got our five before you said that,
Centurion.
Mr. Adams. How about 100 million guinea pigs?
That's not money.
Guinea? A guinea isn't money. You've never been in England.
Well, not with pigs, it isn't.
No, but with Englishmen, if you can make a distinction, it is.
1 shilling more.
Next question. The next question from Elizabeth Teller of Waterloo, New York. Give the name of a prize fighter who won the heavyweight championship of the world on the following counts. 1, on a foul. 2, a decision on points. 3, a towel tossed in the ring. And 4, a technical knockout. I'll go through these again. Name of a prize fighter who won the heavyweight championship of the world on a foul. Mr. Levant.
Schmeling.
Schmeling. From whom did he win it?
Sharkey, Jack Sharkey.
That's quite right. Or is that right, Mr. Kieran?
That's right.
All right. 2, a decision on points. Mr. Kieran.
Sharkey from Schmeling.
Yes. Would there be any other that you could think of?
Why, yes.
Tunney from Dempsey.
Tunney twice. Well, Tunney defended it the second time, but he won it from Dempsey in Philadelphia.
And would Braddock from Bear be right?
Yes.
Braddock from Bear. Well, there are three or four of them here. Not right?
No, that's right.
Right, Mr. Kieran?
That's right.
Mr. Kieran says it's right. It's right. 3, a towel tossed in the ring. A towel tossed in the ring. Mr. Kieran?
Johnson. Jack Johnson. Over Jeffries.
Johnson over Jeffries.
Well, it stopped, finally.
Probably it's a little before my time, but I'm sure it's right if you say so. You didn't see the fight, did you?
No, I didn't see the fight.
You remember the towel?
No.
Don't remember
the towel in my hotel.
Do you want to withdraw that, or will we say
that's
right?
Yes, I want to withdraw that.
Mrs. Norris?
Wasn't it Lewis over Schmeling this last summer?
A towel tossed in the ring?
Right.
Is that right, Mr. Kieran?
That is not right.
He didn't win the championship.
That is right.
I'm awfully sorry, Mrs. Norris.
That is not right. Mr. Kieran
says it's not right.
A towel tossed in the ring means nothing here now in this area.
I see. Well, now, the proper answer is what, Mr. Kieran? Are you sure of it now?
I wouldn't know the proper answer.
Dempsey from Willard be right?
Willard did not come out for the
fourth round.
Then my information is incorrect. I understand the towel was thrown in by Willard second.
No, the round was completed.
My information may be wrong. We'll cross that out, and if you get the next one right, we'll count the whole question as right. A technical knockout. Won the heavyweight championship of the world on a technical knockout.
Heavyweight championship?
Yeah, heavyweight championship.
Well, Lewis and Schmeling. No, he had the championship.
I think not, Mr.
No, I'm wrong. He had the championship.
There is no such thing as technical knockout.
There is no such thing as a technical knockout. Do you want me to throw out this whole question on a technicality?
No, it's all right. I mean, a lot of people talk about it.
How about it, Mr.
Baron Carnera?
Baron Carnera is the answer that I have down here. Now, Mr. Kieran, if you think that's wrong,
will you
meet me in the squared circle sometime after this is all over? All right. Next question from Monroe Rubinger in New York City. This question deals with symphonic music. You have to answer the following questions about symphonic music. There are 5 parts to the question. You have to get 4 out of 5. 1, name a symphony. Mr. Adams, you look very confident.
No, I'm resting.
Oh, all right. 1, name a symphony in which the human voice is employed. Mr. Levant.
Beethoven's 9.
Yes, that's right. 2, name a symphonic piece in which a phonographic record is played. Mr. Levant.
Pines of Rome by Respighi.
That's right. And how is it used?
Victrola record. They have a record.
Yes, a record of what, though?
Of a bird singing.
Well, yes, which bird? Name your bird.
They all sound alike to me. Mr. Kieran.
How about Mr. Kieran?
Must be a nightingale.
Don't know the bird?
It must be a nightingale.
It is a nightingale. Don't be so modest, Mr. Kieran. Mr. Kieran knew it was a nightingale all along. 3, name a symphony in which an organ is used. Mr. Levant.
Saint-Saëns, number 3, C something, major or minor, I don't know.
I guess just called the organ symphony, isn't it?
It's number 3
by folks like me.
Yeah.
4, name a symphony in which all the musicians except 2 leave the platform before its completion. Mr. Levant again.
It's by Haydn.
Yes, what's it called?
Surprise.
No, not quite. Not quite.
Not surprise?
No, not surprise. You seem very surprised.
Surprise.
Now get surprise off your mind.
It's an anti-union kind of racket, that symphony.
All
the boys walk out.
Haydn's Farewell Symphony.
Really?
Yes, that's what it says here. Haydn's Farewell. That sounds right, doesn't it?
They're all the same to me. Every Haydn symphony is the same to me.
Farewell Symphony.
No surprise.
Name a symphony in which a taxi horn is heard. Mr. Levant.
It's not a symphony. It's a tone poem by Gershwin, American in Paris, but that's
yes.
not a symphony.
Well, we're going to call it a symphony for the next 2 or 3 seconds. I'm going to say symphony. Symphony. All right, we got 4.5 out of 5, thanks to Mr. Levant.
Mr. Fadiman.
Yes, Mrs. Norris.
Could we drop those musical questions? They all symphony to me.
Oh, thank you, Mrs. Norris. Mr. Norris, I'm going to ask you back. Now, so far, we announced the loss of exactly $10. And now, Mr. Cross, this is our custom. We're going to allow you 1 minute as our expert on Canada Dry.
Thank you, Mr. Fadiman. To most people, ginger means pep. That's why we say for a quick pickup, an inward refreshener, drink a tall glass of sparkling Canada Dry ginger ale. A secret process brings out the full, rich flavor of the world's best ginger. So please remember that with meals or whenever you want a lift, drink Canada Dry. It's gingivating. By the way, have you sent for your Information Please game? Here's a game that's fun for old and young alike, for now you can play Information Please at home, just like the experts do here in the studio. It's easy for everyone to get an Information Please game. Send to Canada Dry, 1 Pershing Square, New York, or if you live in Canada, Canada Dry, Toronto, Canada, 10 cents, your name and address, and a label from 2 bottles of any of Canada Dry's beverages. Might be 1 ginger ale and 1 sparkling water label. In any event, simply remove enough of these labels to identify them. Since the labels are only glued on 2 edges, they can be easily removed by cutting in a little from the left or right-hand side.
Thank you, Mr. Cross. You are 5 seconds over, but it sounded like a very important announcement. Let it go this evening. Now, suppose we go on with the next half of the program. This question comes from Miss Edith Engel of Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. Now, Mrs. Norris and gentlemen, what book or play might you recommend to each of the following because of the aptness of its title? This is a test of your ingenuity. 1, Rip Van Winkle. What book or play would you recommend to Rip Van Winkle? Book or play with a very apt title. Mr. Levant.
How to Win Friends and Influence People.
I don't know that I'd accept that one.
Well, it did all right with me. I slept.
Not sure that I'd accept that. I'd like to have a better one than that.
The Great Waltz. It's the same thing.
Great Waltz? No, we'll take that one. How, Mr. Adams, do you have one?
Now You Can Sleep.
Is that a title of a book?
Mm-hmm.
Who wrote it?
He mentioned it. I think his name was Jacobson.
I beg pardon?
Dr. Jacobson. Recent book.
All right. I'll accept it. Subject to further inquiry. That's one. What book or play would you recommend to Venus de Milo? Mr. Adams.
Arms and the Man.
Very good. Very good. Did you have an alternative, Mr. Kieran?
Live Alone and Like It.
Not so good for Venus de Milo, I think. Just
no
the opposite,
arms
probably.
In the Man, I think.
I beg pardon?
No Arms in the Man.
Yes, or A Farewell to Arms might
farewell
be even better,
yes.
Robinson Crusoe. Have to get 4 out of 5 on this. What book would you recommend to Robinson Crusoe? Either before or after he met Friday. Mrs. Norris, do you have an idea? Book or play?
5-day week.
No, I won't take that one. Yes, Mr. Kieran?
The Man Who Was Thursday.
It's a tricky idea, Mr. Kieran, but I don't think quite apt for the purpose. There's one very good one that you'd recommend to Robinson Crusoe during the period in which he was without a man Friday. Mr.
Treasure Adam. Island.
Treasure Island. I'll accept that. I think that'd be perfectly all right. Live Alone and Like It, I think, might be even better. 4, Silas Marner. Silas Marner. Book or play? Mr. Kieran.
Brewster's Millions.
Brewster's Millions? Yes, that's possible.
Possible?
Probable. How about another one? A play, a very recent play.
Oh, I don't know about the recent play. How about the Gold Rush?
Yes, the Gold Rush would be all right.
You can't take it with you?
Yes, thank you very much, Mrs. Norris. That's quite right. You can't take it with you. And 5th and last, Henry the Eighth. Henry the Eighth. Mr. Levant.
Having a Wonderful Time.
Oh, Mr. Levant. I suppose I'll have to take that. Next question. This comes from Miss Mildred L. Joy of Koskob, Connecticut. Explain the origin of the following phrases that we constantly use. There are 3 of them, and we have to get the origin of all 3. 1, not worth a continental. Mr. Kieran.
Why, the continental soldiers were paid off after the Revolutionary War in some sort of paper money that wasn't worth much, and it caused two rebellions, one of which was Shays' rebellion up in New England. And so that term of reproach attached to that sort of money.
That's exactly correct. The second phrase, thumbs up and thumbs down, two that go together. Mr. Kieran, again.
That comes from the Roman gladiator days.
Yes,
when the gladiator who put up a good fight, he could appeal to the audience, the spectators, and if they held their thumbs up, his life was spared, and if they held their thumbs down, why...
Yes, the opposite happened. Actually, if they held their thumbs out, he was killed, and if they concealed their thumbs, they granted him mercy. But we have come to think of it as thumbs up and thumbs down. Nowadays, thumbs up, of course, has a totally different signification. What does it mean usually?
All right.
It means okay.
Yes, thank you, Mrs. Norris. Hitchhiking, of course.
All right.
Third. The origin of the third expression. The third expression is Achilles' heel. Mrs. Norris.
Achilles' heel was the only sensitive part of Achilles.
And what about it? What happened as a result of his having
that? That's as far as I go with Achilles, Frank.
Not sensitive, vulnerable.
Vulnerable.
Vulnerable, yes. Do you want to finish that up, Mr. Adams? And what does it mean in ordinary parlance today?
The sensitive spot.
Yes, particularly a vulnerable spot.
The vulnerable spot, yes.
Yes, that's right.
He was dipped in the river, but his mother held him by the heel, and that was the only part that was didn't get the soothing
influence. That's the complete story, Mr. Kieran. Thank you very much. That
used to be a Frank?
Achilles is here. We've got it now. It used to be the most famous heel in history, as a matter of fact, though there's been a lot of competition lately. The next question from Mr. Sidney Mailman of Brooklyn, New York. Oh, Mrs. Norris, I don't know whether we ought to give you this question. Have you ever read any of the Frank Marriwell stories? You don't have to admit that you've read them if you don't wish
to. Yes, I did, but it was back in Chester B. Arthur's administration, and I don't...
Oh, come.
I don't seem to remember them very well.
You must have nine lives like a cat. All right, here are four questions based upon the Frank Marriwell stories, and we have to get every one of the questions correctly answered. One, what university did the Marriwells attend? Mr. Levant.
Yale.
Yale. Yale's most famous alumni. That's quite true. Two, what was the name, either the first or the last name, of Frank's sweetheart? That's a tough one. I'm not talking to you, Mr. Adams. I mean Frank Marriwell.
Frank Marriwell was his sweetheart, the way I read it. He was...
Oh, you sound like a literary critic.
He was pretty stuck on himself.
No, he was awfully stuck on himself. That's quite true. It was a lifelong love affair, but there was a girl involved.
Mary Bryant, it usually isn't Paramount Pictures.
No, won't go. There was a real girl involved. Any of you remember either the first or the last name? It was Inza Burridge. I can't think of any more useful piece of information than that. Inza Burridge. We got that one wrong. Third, who was the aboriginal friend of the Marriwells? The aboriginal friend of the Marriwells. Mr. Adams, you usually remember these things.
I never read Frank Marriwell at all.
Didn't you really?
No. Nope.
Are you going to now?
No.
Well, it was Joe Crowfoot, an Indian. And finally, what was Frank's famous pitching delivery? Ought to get that one out of you, Mr. Kieran. Frank's famous pitching delivery. What was it called? Don't have to remember.
Screwball.
No. The double shoot, because it curved both ways. Did you remember that now, Mr. Kieran? Well, that's going to cost Canada Dry $10, going to Mr. Sidney Mailman of Brooklyn, New York. The next question. This is from Mrs. Frances Frederick Phillips of Verona, New Jersey. What singers of jazz made the following sounds famous? Now, I'll have to give you these sounds as correctly as I can.
Boop, 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 doop, boop, 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 boop. Helen Kane.
Helen Kane, thank you, Mr. Levant. Next one, I don't know whether I can sing this. Boo, 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 boo. Oh, do you know that one, Mr. Levant?
Bing Crosby.
Bing Crosby, yes, that's right. Heidi, 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 ho. Mr. Levant.
Cab Calloway.
And ha-cha-cha-cha.
Jimmy Durant.
Oh, well, you know all that. Too easy.
That's wonderful.
Joe Crowfoot.
You don't spend your time in the proper place. That sticks in your Crowfoot, doesn't it, Mr. Levant? The next question from Mary Alice Clements of Atlanta, Georgia. Give the names of the characters who are known by the following expressions or phrases. One, the Count of Monte Cristo. The Count of Monte Cristo. What was his real name?
Edmond Dantes.
Thank you very much, Mr. Kieran. Two, Madame Butterfly. Mrs. Norris, did you...
Cho-Cho San.
Thank you, Mrs. Norris. Three, the Man Without a Country.
Just saw it in the Warner Brothers short.
I know, and you should remember the name. We all should know that one. Mrs. Norris, do you remember?
Nolan?
Yes, first name?
Ed.
Philip.
Philip.
Philip is right. Well, I think we'll give you a full score on Nolan. For The Lady with the Camellias. Mr. Kieran?
Marguerite Gautier.
Marguerite Gautier, yes. And five, The Hunchback of Notre Dame. Mr. Kieran?
Quasimodo.
Yes, all on Cheney. That's quite correct. Now, see what you can do with this one. This one comes from Mr. R.C. Fuller of Allen Park, Michigan. Give five retorts from father as Junior asks for a little spending money. Mrs. Norris, we'll let you in as a mother on this one. It's really the same situation. Five possible retorts.
When Junior asks for a little spending money? Father? Ask
yes.
Your mother.
Ask your... Oh, that's the one you know, Mrs.
Yes.
Norris. Thank you very much. That's one. Mr. Adams?
You better have a little more.
I never heard it said. Oh,
no.
Ironically, I get it.
Ah,
yep.
Yes.
All right, two. Mr. Levant.
No, I mean it.
Do you? Oh, what a nice family you belong
oh,
to,
wonderful.
Mr. Adams. Mr. Levant.
Go away, you little bum. What am I, a millionaire?
And what a dreadful family you come from, Mr. Levant. That's three. Mr. Kieran.
When I was a boy, I never had any such money given to me.
Yes, that's the one I remember, Mr. Kieran. And five. Let's have one more. Yes, Mrs. Norris.
What do you do with all this money?
Yes, that's a very good one. Well, information please announces a final loss of $20. I think we did very well tonight. Mr. Cross?
I'm curious to know who our guests will be next week. But I'm also curious to know how many of our audience have remembered to send for their information please game. Here is a game two or more can play and have a wonderful evening. This game permits you to play information please just as they do here in the studio, except that you and your friends are the experts. Now, here's how you get your game. Send to Canada Dry, 1 Pershing Square, New York, or if you live in Canada, Canada Dry, Toronto, Canada, 10 cents, your name and address, and a label from 2 bottles of any of Canada Dry's beverages. Might be 1 ginger ale and 1 sparkling water label. In any event, simply remove enough of these labels to identify them. Since the labels are only glued on 2 edges, they can be easily removed by cutting in a little from the left or right-hand side.
Thank you. Now, here's the quartet of experts for next Tuesday. Mr. Kieran again, Mr. Adams again, Mr. Mark Duffield of the New York Herald Tribune, and as our very distinguished guest of honor, a gentleman whose name is a household word wherever wit is honored, a star of the stage, of radio, and of literature, the suave and imperturbable Dr. Alexander Wolcott. Letters with questions, remember, to be addressed to Information, Please, Canada Dry, 1 Pershing Square, New York City. All questions become the property of Information, Please, 1 Pershing Square, New York City.
As we bid Mr. Fadiman good night, let me remind you that Canada Dry Ginger Ale, Sparkling Water, Lime Ricky, and Tom Collins Mixer come in convenient-sized bottles for every occasion.